God's been good to me, and I bless him for it.
Amen, son. We're turning our Bibles this morning to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. I want us to continue our series of studies on the person and work of the Holy Spirit. I wrestle with whether I should continue that series being only one service in the next couple of weeks, but I still was directed to do so as I prayed and I waited before the Lord, and I thank him for his direction. When you have found your place in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, I want you to stand. Also, we will be making a reference to Romans chapter 8, which is our portion of scripture that we've used from the very beginning on the teaching concerning the person and work of the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, beginning with verse 1. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you ignorant. You know that ye were Gentiles, carried away unto these dumb idols, even as ye were led. Wherefore I give you to understand that no man speaking by the Spirit of God calleth Jesus accursed, and that no man can say that Jesus is the Lord but by the Holy Ghost. Now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are differences of administrations, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of operations, but it is the same God which worketh all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to everyone to profit withal. May the Lord bless the reading of His Word and give us enlargement as we study it together. And I'm turning quickly to Romans chapter 8, and I will read only two or three verses here. Verse 7, it says, because the carnal mind, this is the lost man, it's the operation of the flesh and in the flesh of the lost man, because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So the Bible tells us that a lost man cannot serve the Lord. He can't be subject to the things of God, and he is an enemy toward Christ. And he tells us why in the next two verses. So then they that are in the flesh, look at it clearly, cannot please God. People that are lost without Jesus Christ cannot please God. Right. Look at verse 9. But ye are not in the flesh. He's talking to the believers at Rome and to us here in the application. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. Thanks be to God, every born again child of God has the living Spirit of God living in his heart and in his life. That part of man that is born again is the Spirit. That which is born of the Holy Spirit is the Spirit. What a great blessing it is to understand that the victorious Christian life is lived not by our flesh and the energy of our flesh, but by the power of the Holy Spirit that lives in us, that enables us and acts in our will to help us to live the Christian life for His honor and glory. There's no excuse. I hear young people and old alike say sometimes, well, if I thought I could live the Christian life, I would become a believer. Let me share this with you. Without Christ Jesus regenerating you and coming into your heart and life, you'll never be able to live for Jesus Christ. Amen. You must be born again. Amen. And may God be pleased to even regenerate today in these services someone that He will make alive unto God. Amen. Yes. And empower him and her to live a Christian life for God's glory. Now, Father, we thank you for the Scripture reading today. We thank you for the Word of God that has quickened us and made us alive unto God. And Lord, I want to thank you for the potential of this hour. Amen. I pray the Holy Spirit of God will lay hold of some lost sinner's heart today. May they be brought to the end of themselves in repentance and faith in Jesus Christ. Lord, do what to this congregation cannot do. Born again, a sinner today. Again, Father, we all are miracles of your grace. We thank you for that. But now we ask you, Lord, to do it again. We know that no true child of God is content unless God keeps saving sinners and adding them to the local church. Now, Father, we ask you to do that. In honor and glory and praise to yourself. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. You can be seated. As we embark upon the study of the spiritual gifts in a more detailed way, we see that the three major portions of Scripture that deals with the spiritual gifts are Ephesians chapter 4, where it gives us instruction concerning the gifted men that God has given the church. He's given apostles and prophets. And it goes on to say evangelists and, interesting enough, pastors and teachers. Let me just say the purpose of the giving of these gifted men to the church is that they may build up the saints of God in any local church in the faith, that they might do the work of the ministry. Let me again say to you, that means that they understand even that the Holy Spirit indwells them and He can empower them to live the Christian life. I want to say to you that it's significant that we look at not just chapter 12, but chapter 13 and 14 of 1 Corinthians. For in this portion of Scripture, Paul gives more emphasis upon the spiritual gifts. And first, we must be reminded that we must have the indwelling Holy Spirit before we can ever be able to have spiritual gifts, for the gifts come with the person of the Holy Spirit. He gives spiritual gifts to those that He borns into His family. Right. We'll see in chapter 12 that everyone that has been born again and professes Jesus Christ as his or her Savior has a spiritual gift. Some have more than one gift. And what's so important is that the real fulfillment of our Christian faith and our Christian living is seen in our ministering to the body of Christ. Let me share with you, God didn't give you those gifts just for personal edification. God gave you the gifts to minister to those that are a part of the body of Christ in this local assembly. Can I hear an amen? So here we see that every born again believer has the indwelling person of the Holy Spirit indwelling him. And without Him, we can do nothing. Now let me just simply point out to you, and this is a very important part, that God would have you this morning to stop and to think for just a moment, if you're saved and born again, that the eternal God of glory indwells you. That's probably one of the most mind-boggling things that we could think of. The God of eternity lives in the life of every born-again child of God.
Right.
And those that do not have the Holy Spirit are none of His.
Right.
Oh, that God would be pleased, as it teaches us in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20, to get it settled in our thinking, where Paul says, "What, know you not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost?" Amen. He goes on to tell us we're not our own, we're bought with a price. In other words, we are God's purchased saints and purchased believers. And by the grace of God, the Holy Spirit has come to dwell in us. In the Old Testament, it was a temple, and in the temple, the Shekinah glory, the presence of God, would come down and dwell among the people. Amen. And when Israel would move, the presence of God, the Holy Spirit would come outside the temple and would rise in the form of a cloud and lead the children of Israel. But today, every one of us that's born again has the teacher living in our hearts. What a miraculous work of grace. What a great, glorious thought this morning. If you're not saved, you can know Him. Just turn from your sin today. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, who died for sinners. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and in these first six or seven verses, Paul introduces this spiritual gifts, or the subject of the spiritual gifts. Now, God is the source of our spiritual gifts. Now, if you say, well, we see there's spiritual gifts that are in the church at Peachtree. I do too. I see spiritual gifts here. But I also see that the church at Corinth had spiritual gifts. And interestingly enough, the church at Corinth was carnal. You say, what do you mean? They operated in the flesh instead of faith. And you say, what does that mean? That means that the membership was not cooperating with the person of the Holy Spirit in living holy lives, being clean vessels that the Spirit of God might perform miracles through their lives to live victoriously. And so there was the writing of First Corinthians to straighten out all of the problems that were in the church and to deal with them and address them. And many of those are carried over even into our generation. But notice the expression in verse 1. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you ignorant. I think it's significant, a couple of things that I want to point out, and then we'll launch into the study proper. But I want to point out to you that, number one, the word gifts is in italics. Anytime we find in our King James Bible that a word is in italics, it is added for better understanding. The whole idea is the context deals with it, but this particular verse does not. So if you will, look at it with me and read it without it. Now concerning spiritual bread, I would not have you ignorant. Now I want to say to you that if there's ever an area of ministry in our generation where the charismatic movement, etc., is so taking a hold, not only here in America, it has led astray many, but it's overseas as well. Dr. Celius and I went into Egypt and began to teach national pastors there, and literally, I will say this, it took us 3 to 4 years of going in and out and teaching before we ever got all of the misconceptions about the person and work of the Holy Spirit out of the thinking of the pastors. There's a lot of deception. The important thing is God wants us to be spiritual. Has it dawned on you now concerning spirituality? Let me just say this to you. You can have all the gifts in the world, but if we are not a spirit-filled people, meaning by that controlled by the Holy Spirit, there will be no fruit for Christ's glory.
Right.
Now let me just go on and put it before you in this manner. God's not pleased with us being ignorant. He's, you know, being ignorant of what God is teaching in His Word, that doesn't help you. The Bible tells us that in John chapter 4, when the woman at the well was addressed by the Lord Jesus, He told her, they that worship Him, talking about God, must worship Him in spirit and in truth. It's very important for us to understand that never does the spirit go contrary to truth.
That's right.
And never is truth contrary to the true working of the Holy Spirit. There seems to be a great deal of ignorance about spiritual gifts in the day of Corinthian church, but also in our day as well. Look at verses 8 and 9. They seem to indicate that spiritual gifts are given by the Holy Spirit. Now we have learned, look at verse 8 and 9, it says, for to one is given by whom? The Spirit, the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, the gifts of healing by the same Spirit, etc. And it goes on and repeats it. Here's what we learn from these verses is that spiritual gifts come from the person of the Holy Spirit.
Right.
Now, when we learn that, Paul insists that the gifts be put under a Bible test. You say, what do you mean as you're going along? Look at verse 3 of chapter 12. Wherefore I give you to understand that no man speaking by the Spirit of God calleth Jesus accursed, and that no man can say that Jesus is the Lord but by the Holy Ghost. Now, what he's saying is there's a biblical test set forth here. You'll never hear the Holy Spirit of God rejecting the Lordship of Jesus Christ.
Right.
You'll never hear the Holy Spirit at any time blaspheming or cursing the name of God.
Right.
He will forever exalt and glorify him. I want to say the gifts which are truly from God will always honor and glorify God. John insists on it as well in 1 John, and I ask you to turn there. These are good verses for us to see these truths. But notice in 1 John chapter 4 what he tells us. Here, John the Beloved, along with Apostle Paul, is emphasizing that there should be a putting of the spirits to the test. Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God. Is it possible to have another spirit? According to 1 Corinthians chapter 11, it is. And we'll talk about that in just a moment. But look at this. He says, but try the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets are going out into the world. Hereby know we ye the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesseth that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is of God. So there's two aspects of it, and we can find it in other places as well. The power of the Holy Spirit of God always confesses that Jesus Christ came in the flesh. He's virgin born. Amen. And he was a prepared vessel to die upon the cross of Calvary to pay our sin debt. But also, those that realize that the Holy Spirit not only honors the human nature of our Lord Jesus Christ, but also his deity.
Absolutely.
Listen to me. If there is a denial of the deity of Jesus Christ, then there's something wrong with the doctrine. I will go ahead and say this. You say, well, Pastor, you'll just hurt people's feelings. Well, truth makes you free.
Yes.
But truth also hurts. But Mormonism does not teach that Jesus Christ is God. Come in the flesh. Mormonism teaches that Jesus became God. Jesus did not become God. He was as eternal as God the Father, God the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go on in record. Let us understand Jehovah's Witnesses do the same thing. They do not teach that Jesus was God come in the flesh. They teach that he became God and that you and I can become little gods as well. That's heresy.
Right.
Amen. You and I are born again by the grace of God. We become daughters of God and sons of God, but we are never God.
Right.
Paul insists that the gifts be put under biblical scrutiny. Gifts which are truly from God will always honor and glorify Jesus Christ. And 1 John 4, 1 to 3 also warns us in this area. We could look at Paul's warning. In 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 12, he says to discern the spirits, whether they be of God. Let me just simply say to you, the only means of discerning the spirit is spirit and truth. Truth always magnifies the person of the Holy Spirit as God. It also, we learn that the spirit will always magnify the Son Jesus Christ by honoring the Word of God. Can I hear an amen? Secondly, I point out to you this morning that spiritual gifts are not to be confused with natural abilities or talents.
Right.
Somebody said, well, he really got a talent to play the piano, but does he have spiritual enlargement that enables him to minister to the hearts of people? We're going to develop this for a few moments. You know, there's a lot of people who profess to be called to preach today that have no call of God. Do you know they're successful? Some of them are successful. Some of them are out there building churches, they're building international works. Some of them are doing great works, and people look at them and say, well, what's the use in having spiritual gifts if you can do it without them? It's not the same.
Amen.
There is a difference in the work of the flesh and fruit of the Holy Spirit.
Right.
And we'll talk about that in just a moment. God will use any talent surrendered to him, but doesn't necessarily mean that he's going to use your talent. Now, if your talent connects with a spiritual gift, then I promise you it'll just enhance the gift. Spiritual gifts are different in that they come from God and produce fruit by God's power versus a religious activity in the energy of the flesh. Thirdly, in our study, spiritual gifts come from the Greek word charisma. Now, it is literally a gift of grace. That's what it literally means.
Right.
And God gives the gift out of his grace. Amen. So if you have a spiritual gift, let me just say this to you. God has given you something that you don't normally have. You say, what do you mean by that? A person can have a gift to teach and be an excellent school teacher and not be able to minister to the hearts when opening and teaching the Bible. If you have a gift to teach from the Spirit of God, all you have to do is just serve God and stay faithful to God, the Word of God, and the things of God, and teach everything you've been taught, and it works. God will use it to teach others. And God will use it to bring out grace in the lives of others. God gives the gift out of his grace. Otherwise, there would be no gifts. None. There'd be no spiritual gifts at all in the church of the Lord Jesus Christ if it was not for gifts that come by the grace of the Holy Spirit. A spirit gift is a divine enablement by God's Holy Spirit who enables one to do something he could not otherwise do.
That's right, absolutely.
You say, Pastor Dave, what do you say? Most of us that preach and teach the Word of God generally say, well, I thank God he called me. And you know what they generally think? I didn't want this job. You say, Pastor David, did you want the job? I wanted the job, but I didn't want the job. You know why? But I didn't think I could do it. And you know what God proved to me? I can't. You know what God proves to you and to me? We can't do spiritual work without the power of the Holy Spirit. That's when he commands us to be spirit-filled, to be controlled by the Holy Spirit. It is possible for one to appear to be successful in ministry without the call of God. And I'm going to tell you this. He may produce works, but he'll never produce fruit. Turn with me in your Bible, if you will, to another portion of Scripture that's very much related to all this, and that's Galatians chapter 5. In Galatians chapter 5, we have, particularly starting at verse 16 of chapter 5, how he emphasizes the difference between the works of the flesh and the works of the Holy Spirit in a believer. Look at verse 16 of verse 5. He tells us, this I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Do you know what the lust of the flesh is in the local church when an individual is trying to do the work of the ministry in the energy of the flesh? Bringing attention to himself. Listen to it. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Holy Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. There is a war that goes on the inside of every born-again child of God. And if he's born again and the Holy Spirit's living in him, that war is against operating in the flesh. You know what we do? We grieve the Holy Spirit. You know the other aspect of it is that the enemy, the flesh, it will grieve God, the Holy Spirit, when we give over to it. And these are the contrary. One to the other, so that ye cannot do the things of the that you would. All right, so if you're not empowered, you don't have the power of the Holy Spirit, you don't have spiritual gifts, you can't do what you would. Now notice this. But if ye be led of the Spirit, you're not under the law. We have been liberated by grace, amen? I don't have to feel like I've got to serve God. I won't serve God.
Right.
It's not just in there, man. You're going to have to measure up to church. You're going to have to start serving God. Let me just say this to you. It's not a mandate by the law of God nor by the local church.
Amen.
You know what it is? It is an outflow of life. It is the outflow of the reality of the person of the Holy Spirit working in and through us. But if we be led of the Spirit, we're not under the law. Now verse 19. Now I want you to notice this. Now the works of the flesh of these, underline the word works. Notice what he says. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, various emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envies, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and revilings, and such like, all of which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. I don't know if you know it or not, but that's real powerful.
Yes, sir.
You know what it's saying? If you have not the Spirit, you're not his. You know what it's saying? You don't do the work of the church and the ministry in the energy of the flesh.
Right.
You know what? It pulls everything back to us, and it magnifies us rather than ministry to others. Now look at the Spirit. Here's the contrast. But here we have a conjunction in verse 22. But the fruit, now what did he call the flesh?
Works,
the works of the flesh. But what does he say here? The fruit of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I don't care who you are. I got some pear trees in my backyard. But I don't care who you are. You cannot grow pears like those pear trees. Old brother back here to grin with us, Brother Gary, he sent me up some blueberries. Had more blueberries this year than I ever had. Woo, there's so many blueberries. They run out. But nobody in this building can produce blueberries. They grow on the vine. They grow on the bush. Let me just simply say to you, it's fruit that the Spirit produces in you. If you don't have fruit in your life, that's the reason we hear it said all the time. Without fruit, there's no evidence you're a child of God.
Right.
Amen. Notice what he talks about here. But the fruit of the Spirit is, here we go, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not be desirous of vainglory, provoking one another, envying one another. You say, preacher, what are you saying to us? There is a difference in religious work in a church and the power of the Holy Spirit producing fruit in lives. Now, let me just say to you, the Spirit-filled life is a command. Ephesians 5:18, we're commanded to be Spirit-filled. That means that we want to be controlled by the Holy Spirit. Why? that we produce fruit. See, I can't produce fruit. You can't produce fruit. Only the Holy Spirit can do it. But you know what He's chosen to do? He has chosen to produce fruit through channels called born again believers that have been born again by the grace of God. The Holy Spirit enables one to do something he could not otherwise do.
Absolutely.
Amen. You say, Pastor David, what are you saying? God can give you the right word for a sinner if you have a gift of evangelism that would help him or her to get on to faith in Jesus Christ and work a miracle of grace.
Yes.
It is possible for one to appear to be successful, as I've already stated, and never produce any fruit. The difference is understanding religion, and all it can produce is works of the flesh, while the difference is the work of the Holy Spirit in us empowers us to produce fruit, making us channels only. God does the work through them and through us. It is more than God's blessing, our efforts, or our works. Well, I go to church, I'm as good as anybody else down there, and I try to do good works. I don't know why God doesn't bless it. That's not what he's talking about. You have not the Spirit of God, you're none of his.
Right.
The fruit of the Spirit comes as a result of the Holy Spirit indwelling you. And it's illustrated for us in John 15. He said, I am the vine and you're the branches. Amen. You know what he says? Without the sap that comes up out of the ground and out of the minerals and resources, which gives life to the branches, and then the fruit grows on the branches. God wants to use you to produce fruit as a branch. Amen. It is God's performing the work. Turn with me for just a moment. Let's look at it a little further. And I can say to you that I've got a ways to go, but the Lord knows that, and I'll just try to be kind to everybody here and get through. But look at Matthew chapter 7. You said this is the words of the Lord Jesus. That's right. And I remember in studying this portion of Scripture many a time in preaching, and look at verse 15. It says, beware of false prophets which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. You know what he's saying? He looks like one of the rest of us. He's among us. Notice, ye shall know them how? By their fruits. Do men gather fruits of thorns or figs of thistles? Even so, every good tree bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruit. A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. Every tree that bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. Then verse 20, wherefore by their fruits ye shall know them. Now, I can't tell who's saved and who's not saved, but by their fruits. Evidence of one's being saved and born again is that there is fruit being produced in their life by the power of the Holy Spirit. Notice what he says in the next verses. This is so important to the study this morning. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. Let me just say this to you. Our churches are full of folk that are saying, Lord, Lord. Huh? But they're not producing any fruit. Look at it further. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? Let me just say this to you one more time. A degenerate, a man without a call from God, can be a successful minister if he uses the techniques of the world in the church. You say, what do you mean? He looks successful. Look at the numbers. Look at the followings. Look at the crowds. Let me just say this to you. There is a difference in works and fruit. One is produced by God, and the other is produced by men. Many will say to me in that day, he said, the day is going to come, there's going to be prophets and preachers and pastors that will stand before God. And many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? Now here it is. And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. Do you know it's possible to be a part of Peachtree Baptist Church in good standing and have everything look like it's going in the right direction, and you look at it and say, well, I think it's fruit. But let me ask you this. Who's getting the glory? Who is not ministering to others? You see, the whole gift of ministry comes up in the power of the Spirit of God. We don't have the Holy Spirit working through us. We have no ministry. Well, it is possible for one to appear to be successful in ministry without the call of God. Now, generally speaking, the latter part of Matthew 7 is a good test. The Bible tells us that you do not build a house upon the sand.
Right.
You build it upon a rock. And notice what it teaches us in that context, that when the storms come and the rains come. Oh, I deliver. I have to be careful what I'm saying here. But I have a neighbor that I try to help all the time. We take bread and stuff to them. It's not their fault. But every time it rains, it washes out their road. I'm telling you, it's like a rug board going down through there. Bam, 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 bam. You know, some folks' lives will not stand the test of trials. Let me just say this to you. They're coming. The greatest trial is when you're standing before God one day, and you won't have anybody there to defend you, because Jesus has not known you, and you've not known him. The difference here, and we might even ask the question, is do you have the Holy Spirit indwelling you? Are you a channel through which the Holy Spirit enables you to worship him in spirit and truth? Did you know one cannot do any work of the ministry if he doesn't see it as worship? I don't stand up here and preach, just to preach, but I'm doing it to honor my God. I want to worship him. What is to worship? Give praise and honor and glory to his name. How do you give praise and honor and glory to his name? By doing it in the Bible way. By doing it in the power of the Holy Spirit. By doing it in the power of Almighty God. God, the purpose of spiritual gifts is to glorify Jesus and edify or build up the local church. Listen to this. And there are differences of administrations, but the same Lord. Your gift may be different, mine may be different from yours, but there's one God orchestrating this thing.
Yes, right. Sir.
I am so glad when I can say with the Ephesian writer that Jesus is the head of his church.
Amen.
Amen. Even here, the pastors are not the head of this local assembly. Listen to me, the deacons are not ahead of the assembly of God at Peachtree Baptist Church. The one that is head of his church, universal, is also head of this local assembly.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. Glory to God, makes me want to run a little. The word administration is significant here. It says, and there are differences of administrations, but the same Lord. The word administrations comes from the Greek word from which we get our word deacon. A deacon is a servant. The word deacon carries with it the concept of to serve. So a deacon is a servant. And here it's used in relation to the ministry. I think it's interesting that he's telling us in light of the spiritual gifts and the ministry in the local church, Paul said that there are different offices and works in respect to the spiritual gifts, but they are all to serve the body of Christ, the local church. Amen. I don't know if you love the local church or not, but I do. I thank God for the local assembly here at Peachtree. Our ministries are not our ministries. Let me just say it one more time. Thank God for the call to preach. But the ministry committed me is not my ministry. It's God's ministry through me, or through Pastor Allen, or through Dr. Lucinus. Secondly, beware of looking at your ministry as the end and forget it is only a means to an end. You want to be put out of ministry right quick. You just try to do it in the energy of the flesh. Just think, I've arrived. The work is mine. And look what I have accomplished. If there's anything accomplished in Peachtree Baptist Church, it's God that does it.
Right, sir.
And he deserves all the glory. For service in our local church is the purpose of his giving us gifts. And fifthly, in our study, note in 1 Corinthians 6, chapter 12, verse 6, there are diversities of operations, but it is the same God which worketh all in all. This word operations is a Greek word from which we get our word energy. And it's interesting, it carries the meaning of what is brought out, or what is brought out of a work, or the effect produced by ministry. This means there is a difference between work, but the one Lord, the different works, in other words, different gifts, but it's important to understand the one Lord. And if we have one sovereign that's in charge, you know what's going to happen? We're going to have unity. You know what else we're going to have? We're going to have substantial spiritual growth. You know what's going to happen? The saints of God will be ministering one to another. What a work of edification. I exhort you to take time to just look at the one another's in the Bible. We're to love one another. We're to pray one for another. We're to forgive one another. Amen. It just goes on and on. You know why? Because God put us in the body as a channel to minister to one another. I often say this, you can't minister when you're not here. Amen. And when somebody's gone, we ought to be looking for them so we can minister to them. Amen. Turn with me to 1 Peter, and I'm coming to a conclusion, whether you believe it or not. 1 Peter, I think this is something that really grasped my heart in our study. And 1 Peter, notice if you will, chapter 4 of 1 Peter, and then verses 10 and 11. As every man hath received the gift, even so minister the same one to another, as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. Praise God. He says our spiritual gifts are gifts of grace, and that the ministry of the grace of God is all in all. It ministers from the same God to the fellow saint. Look at verse 11. If any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of God. If any man minister, let him do it as of the ability which God giveth. May I share this with you? If God doesn't give the ability to minister, you cannot minister. Amen. You say, well, my gift's a gift of helps. Well, the gift of helps, the gift of mercy, or just a genuine gift is the gift of governments. And just note with me, they only operate as we're strong in grace by the power of the Spirit of God. That God in all things may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom the praise and dominion forever and ever. Amen. That's not a bad portion of Scripture. As every man hath received the gift, even so minister the same one to another. Our spiritual gifts are for others. I was reading John MacArthur, and he said, "No, I don't know where anybody got this false concept that it's for self-edification." I've heard men say that gifts of tongues are self-edification, so that you can go in a closet and it'll build you up. That is not taught in the Word of God.
Right.
And I don't mean to be unkind, but nowhere in the Word of God are gifts given to build us up. Gifts are given to build our brothers and sisters in Christ. Okay. Can I hear amen?
Amen.
The purpose of the spiritual gifts is to glorify Jesus Christ and edify his body. And that's in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Well, you've been patient, put up with me, at least for this hour. And I want to say to you that verse 5 says, and there are differences of administrations, but the same Lord. The idea here, of course, as we've stated going through, is the service. So the difference is that he is Lord. By the way, you don't get the gift that you want. You don't ask God, "Give me the gift of tongues." And I hear all that all the time. It says you ask him for the gifts. Let me just say this to you. The Bible makes it clear he gives them sovereignly. You don't get to choose your gift. Look at that 1 Corinthians chapter 12. He says in verse 29, I couldn't read earlier, are all apostles? What would be the natural answer? No. Are all prophets? No. Are all teachers? No. Are all workers of miracles? No. Have all the gifts of healing? No. Do all speak with tongues? No. Do all interpret? No. And yet you got people running around. If you don't speak in tongues, you're not showing the evidence of being born again. That is not taught in the Word of God. What would God have us to see? Well, in conclusion, I will share this with you, and it won't be long, surely. I mean this. The conclusion is this. The spiritual gifts must be divided into two categories. And if you don't get these categories clear in your thinking, there'll be a lot of confusion. There are permanent gifts and there are temporary gifts. And my purpose as we continue in our studies will be to show you that there are gifts that have ceased. You say, why did those gifts cease? Well, I'll admit that some people believe that all the gifts are permanent, but there is confusion that comes out of that. The time period of the early church is known as a transitional period. Now, I'm going to say this because I read a whole lot, but the best work yet to be read is Dr. Seelius on the Spirit-directed life. He talks clearly about the transitional book, the book of Acts. And when there is a transition from Old Testament economy to New Testament economy, the activities of the book of Acts are activities of the Holy Spirit. Of the Holy Spirit. And what's so significant about them is that God tells us there is a new dispensation coming. You say, how do you know that? Well, we had an Old Testament, did we not? Now we have a New Testament. They didn't have this New Testament at the beginning. You know what they had? They had the apostles' doctrine.
That's right.
And you know what? God confirmed that the apostles' doctrine and the apostles were authentic by spiritual gifts. They had sign gifts, and these temporary gifts are called sign gifts. But 1 Corinthians 13 tells us, you know, he said, it's kind of like looking in the mirror. He said, well, from the beginning, he said, you can see in the mirror, but he said, only partly. He said, you've only had partial truth. And then he goes on to say, but then, when it is complete, is a revelation of a New Testament, these gifts shall pass away. Let me just say this to you. That's a general statement, and I'll come back with details next time. Let's stand. I believe the power of the Word of God. And I believe in it so that I can say to you, if I'm preaching on spiritual gifts, God will save a sinner. I may preach in the gospel and God help somebody get straightened out on spiritual gifts. That's just the power of the gospel. And I'm going to say as I come to the conclusion today, if you're here lost without Christ Jesus, I thought as I stood in Alabama at the casket last night, and Lauren Long, who's precious saint of God, came here to church for a long time and drove from Alabama, hour drive, to come to church. And she brought along with her a friend. His name's Cameron. Cameron's 32 years old, and they found him dead this week. You say, well, you just don't know. They all thought things were going well and it was going to work out. In fact, Laura's daddy said to me, we'd hope that in the near future they would marry. But what happened? He died. Let me just say this to you. You're going to die. Amen? You're just other than you're thinking. I'm not here threatening you. I'm here pleading with you. God commands you to repent. God commands you to plead. The preacher can plead, but God doesn't plead. He don't mess around with you. He commands you to repent. You don't repent, then you stand the chance of going out into eternity lost. Are we glad that Cameron had such a good testimony? Lauren said to me, Pastor David, every other page in his diary is full of God's word and how God was talking to him on occasions. Let me just say this to you. There is a reality and there is a real relationship with Jesus Christ, and you can have it and you can know it. Today is the day of salvation. Let's all be real sensitive to the Holy Spirit. I'm going to bow, and we're going to bow. There's not going to be any music. There's not going to be any commotion. We're just simply saying to the sinners that are here, if you know you're lost and you're without Christ, why don't you break with your sin? Because that's all it is. It's pride. It's settled indifference against God. Why don't you run to Jesus? Today is the day of salvation, Lord. Now is the accepted time. With a heart, man believeth unto righteousness. Once your sin removed and righteousness given, believe that Jesus Christ died and paid your sin debt for you. Will you take us through the grace and conclude this service with prayer?
Father, we do thank you for the truth that we've heard today, both in the Sunday school hour, Lord, in the preaching hour this morning. God, we